You're listening to the audio production of My Two Elaines, Learning, Coping, and Surviving as an Alzheimer's Caregiver by Martin J. Schreiber with Kathy Breitenbucher, published by Harper Horizon and read by Martin J. Schreiber, Dr. Michelle Braun, Kristine Haas, Tara Reed, and Mike Terry. Please note that you may download an accompanying PDF that provides enhanced materials for this audiobook. To download the PDF, please visit harperfocusaudio.com.
It wasn't until a few weeks ago that I really had to say, yes, I do have Alzheimer's. I had read of signs that indicate Alzheimer's, like getting overly upset for no reason and having trouble with names and directions, but I still didn't think it was a problem for me. But in hindsight, for too long, I've been getting lost driving, having trouble keeping days straight, and difficulties with names and schedules. Still, I still felt I could handle it. It won't get worse. But this morning, I started reading about the mid-stage of Alzheimer's in hopes of preparing myself better, and I realized I'm not very far away. That is most scary, but I have to accept it. Elaine's letter to her dear loved ones, dated March 11, 2009.
Foreword. The names Martin and Elaine Schreiber will ring a bell for many in Wisconsin, especially political watchers. The story they know is that of the state's 39th governor and his first lady. Since 1962, when Marty won his first political race for state senate, they were familiar faces on the political circuit, crisscrossing the state in campaigns for lieutenant governor, then for governor. They made an elegant couple, greeting Bobby Kennedy, President Carter, and other national leaders who came to Wisconsin. For almost 30 years, election night usually found the Schreibers side by side, watching the returns come in for one of Marty's races, accepting the victories and the defeats with grace. Later, when his own political career had finished, Marty became one of the state's best-known government relations consultants. This is the story I knew in the beginning, the one familiar to so many. But it is not the one you will find in the pages of this book. My Two Elaines is instead the story of what happened to the Schreibers later in life, when Elaine began to show the first signs of Alzheimer's disease, and then gradually, but surely, came under its grip. Although this is the Schreiber's personal tale, many Americans will recognize the broad outlines. Alzheimer's disease is now the sixth leading cause of death in the United States, claiming more than 120,000 lives every year. And the numbers are bound to rise as modern medicine helps us to live longer. Alzheimer's is one of the great health challenges facing mankind in the 21st century. It is also a disease that inspires a unique kind of dread. We find it terrifying to imagine a time when the body will continue to function, but the mind will slip away. So, in practical terms, My Two Elaines is an invaluable guide to millions who will face Alzheimer's in the role of patient or caregiver. In its pages, you will find a knowing and sympathetic guide to the day-to-day work of living with the disease. And it's important you have no illusions, for work it is. Marty is clear about that. When I first got to know the former governor in 2015, I was struck by his honesty. Politicians are gregarious, but on their own terms. They spend so much of their time letting us see only the good qualities, the strong ones. On the campaign circuit, vulnerability may not count for much, but in everyday life, it is deeply underrated. It is the quality that infuses My Two Elaines with its power and makes it a valuable addition to the literature on Alzheimer's. To his great credit, Marty opens his life fully as a husband and Alzheimer's caregiver. He allows readers to see the sorrow, the frustration, and even the anger that comes from watching this disease destroy someone you love. He also describes the small moments of joy that even Alzheimer's cannot take away. but it would not do justice to the book to file it away among the how-to or self-help guides. I read and enjoyed My Two Elaines most of all as a love story. The Schreibers' love for each other shines through on every page. It has endured the worst insults that Alzheimer's heaps on the living. It has endured even as the disease constructs a wall between the couple and the rich years they've shared. In its raw honesty, this book itself is an act of love. Stories make us feel less alone in the world. Marty has generously given us his and Elaine's. Mark Johnson, Pulitzer Prize winner, co-author of One in a Billion, The Story of Nick Volker and the Dawn of Genomic Medicine.
Preface. I felt compelled to write this book in the hope that relating my experience of caring for my wife Elaine, who was diagnosed with Alzheimer's disease in 2007, with the hope that we would help other caregivers learn, cope, and survive. That said, while sharing this message with other caregivers is my primary objective, those who looked over the manuscript told me they believed this book could help a wider audience as well. So, I invite husbands and wives, families and friends to use it to better understand Alzheimer's, to learn how to assist caregivers, and to help patients experience moments of joy even as they daily face the overwhelming sadness of the disease. Because I believe that maintaining a sense of humor is helping me bear up under the stress of Alzheimer's, at the beginning of several chapters, I have included some anecdotes that I hope will make you laugh. If my icebreakers really aren't your style, well, then I ask your forgiveness as you focus on the book's central messages. It wasn't until I was almost finished with the manuscript that I began finding many diaries, notes, and letters that Elaine had written at various times after her diagnosis. These writings sparked sadness, as they led me to realize that at times I hadn't been the best caregiver. Yet, they also brought joy to know that I made her feel happy and that I comforted her, too. Although we had prayed together and cried together many times, until I read Elaine's own words, I never had a full comprehension of her emotions, of her fears and her anxieties, her love, and ultimately her courage. It helped me understand how critically important I was to her as her lifeline, as she faced her daunting future. I am so pleased I can share a fuller picture of Elaine by including her side of the story. Many statistics in this book are cited from the Alzheimer's Association, which has led the world in Alzheimer's care, Alzheimer's support, and research since 1980. For information and support, call the Association's 24/7 helpline, 1-800-272-3900, or you can visit them at www.alz.org. Introduction. I met my first Elaine in 1953 when we were freshmen at what is now called Milwaukee Lutheran High School in southeastern Wisconsin. My last name, Schreiber, and hers, Thaney, put us pretty close in classroom seating. My first Elaine helped me achieve each of my successes and stood by me in every one of my losses and illnesses. She helped me pass biology at the University of Wisconsin, Milwaukee. She worked as a secretary to put me through Marquette University Law School. She pushed our daughter Kathy in a stroller while campaigning door-to-door for my first race in 1962. When I won, she won too. She celebrated with me later that year when I was elected to the Wisconsin State Senate. 4 years later, and pregnant, she kept 4-year-old Kathy and our son Marty, aged 3, neat and presentable, during a station wagon tour of all 72 counties in Wisconsin in my race for lieutenant governor. I lost, but continued to serve in the state senate. I did win election as lieutenant governor in 1970, and eventually we had 4 children. In 1977, I became the 39th governor of Wisconsin. There were more campaigns to run, for governor in 1978 and 82, and mayor of Milwaukee in 1988. I lost those, too, but I was experienced in not always coming out on top. As I've said many times in my life, my role in law school was to assure that there would be an upper 50% of the graduating class. Elaine uncomplainingly went to work as a teacher to get our family back on stable financial ground after my political run ended. I am profoundly grateful for her support. We have lost elections, but she never let me feel defeated. In my second career, I worked in insurance, publishing, and government affairs. The high of being a husband, father, grandfather, and now great-grandfather surpasses any thrill I ever experienced in politics or business. Elaine was as intelligent, kind, gracious, loving, understanding, self-sacrificing, and forgiving as any wife, mother, or grandmother ever could be. She cooked, kept house, raised the children, held dinner parties, dressed stylishly, took me to chemotherapy as I battled cancer, and sailed with me. If it weren't for her, there wouldn't be me. It was about 2005, when she was in her mid-60s, that Elaine began to slip away from me. Her daily skills declined and her interest in long-held hobbies withered. The time came when she couldn't drive without getting lost. Gradually, my constant helpmate became dependent on me for everything. Today, she does not cook, keep house, hold dinner parties, or even dress herself. She got lost on our boat and in our home of 20 years and eventually forgot her family, including me. Even with Alzheimer's disease, Elaine remains as kind, gracious, loving, and self-sacrificing as any person could be. But she's not the same person. My first Elaine gave way to my second Elaine. I have hoped, laughed, and cried with both of them, just as anyone has with their spouse or loved one. And I now have had to acknowledge that the future will not unfold the way I thought it would. My first Elaine and I shared love, hope, happiness, and dreams. As she became my second Elaine, the dreams turned into nightmares because I was losing her. Happiness became hopelessness. Grieving and health issues, including depression and anxiety, replaced joy. I greatly missed my first Elaine. My heart broke as she left me. It was so painful as this new normal enveloped us with Alzheimer's, destroying the memories we had created over decades. I still love her, of course, but in quite a different way, and I still want to make her happy, even when she is confused, unsettled, anxious, and much less aware of most things in life. One day, about 5 years into her disease, the second Elaine asked me how we got together. "Well," I told her, when you were 14, I saw how pretty and smart you were, and I was determined that I wanted you for my wife, and if any other boys got within 50 feet of you, I bopped them on the head. "You're a bullshitter," she said. My first Elaine never would have used language like that. When it came out, it was a bit shockingly funny. So I laughed, and she laughed. The new Elaine was speaking out. We shared an unexpected moment of joy. "Well," I said, "let's just keep that between you and me." "Oh, no," she insisted. "It won't do any good. Everybody already knows." It is said that there are more books written about Abraham Lincoln than any other subject in American nonfiction. When your spouse has dementia, you might feel that our 16th president has given way to Dr. Alois Alzheimer, the German physician who was a pioneer in the study of memory loss. Before I became an Alzheimer's caregiver, I never imagined there was so much material out there, medical journals, memoirs, poetry, essays, and more. Sadly, with an estimated 6.2 million age 65 and older currently living with Alzheimer's, and 13.8 million expected to be challenged by the disease by the year 2060. It's a growing industry. Over the course of my wife's 18-year struggle with Alzheimer's, I've looked at plenty of those books. I didn't benefit much from the bookish science stuff or the bullet point how-tos. Not one of the books I read conveyed the ugly truth about caregiving, that it can destroy you, even kill you, if you go about it wrong. I hope this book speaks to you so that you can help your partner on his or her Alzheimer's journey, that they can help you be the best caregiver possible and survive. What I have learned over the past almost two decades will, I hope, make a difference in your life and that of your loved one. I have hiked up the Alzheimer's mountain.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.